nothing that could satisfy. A piece for the hurt I have buried deep inside. Knees on the floor, I finally found everything I need. You lifted my soul and opened up my eyes. Chasing after what won't last. I'm done with building these castles that crumble like sand.
Yeah. song in my soul, and I feel it stirring in me. Yes, I know for sure that your love is like a flood, and your mercy never ending. I give my soul to you. There's a joy in my soul.
Good morning, church family. It's great to have you join us. My name is Jason Hyde. I'm one of the pastors here at SEMC. Thanks for joining us on our live stream this morning. We're thankful that you've chosen to join us from wherever you are this morning. If you are new to us or have recently started tuning in to our live stream services, we'd love to hear from you and know who you are. And so please send us an email, or you can comment on our YouTube channel or through Facebook or however it is that you are connecting with us. We promise not to stalk you or to send you lots of junk mail or anything like that. For our invocation this morning, I want to read from Psalm 66, verses 16 to 20. Come and listen, all you who fear God, and I will tell you what he did for me. For I cried out to him for help, praising him as I spoke. And if I had not confessed my sin in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. But God did listen. He paid attention to my prayer. Praise God, who did not ignore my prayer or withdraw his unfailing love from me. Let's continue this morning in our worship of our Lord and Savior, the one who hears us and listens to our prayers.
Good morning, church. It's a new day. The sun is, I think, trying to shine through the clouds. The snow is beautiful. His mercies are new to us, for us this morning. It's a privilege to worship together today again, albeit from afar, but we'll be together again soon, hopefully. And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord. And my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name." Let's worship together.
This will be a Hey guys, come with me. I want to show you something really cool. Did you know that our church has fossils? And no, I don't mean those of us with gray hair in the congregation. I'm talking about the remains of ancient plants and animals, actual bones and shells that have been turned into rock or left an imprint in the rock. When our church was built, they brought in this rock, limestone, and had fossils imprinted all over it. These creatures lived many, many years ago. And when they mined this rock to use in our church, these fossils were uncovered. Isn't it amazing that something that lived so many years ago still has left its imprint here in our church today? It's kind of like the Bible. The Bible was written many, many years ago, but it still applies to our lives today. Just like the fossil is imprinted in the limestone, we want God's word to be imprinted in our life. Deuteronomy 11:18 says, "Imprint these words of mine on your hearts and minds. Bind them as a sign on your hands, and let them be a symbol on your foreheads." And how do we do this? By reading our Bible, praying, memorizing scripture, and applying God's truth to our life. Next time we're able to meet in church, I want you guys to take some time to see if you can find the fossils that are around. And remember that when God's word is imprinted on your life, you are able to make a mark on someone else's.
Thanks, Laura and your team, for putting those videos together. That's really good. I really miss seeing you all every week. I probably say this every week, but it's true. I also miss the moment in our services where we greet one another. And so we were thinking, perhaps we can still do this in this time, even if we're not physically together. And so therefore, what I'd like you to do, invite you to do, is take like 30 seconds starting right now and send someone a text message. Let them know that you miss them, that you're thinking about them, or say good morning to someone on the YouTube chat or through Facebook or whatever it is that you're connecting with people. Take a few seconds and send a message like that. And then as you do that, I'm just going to imagine some of your faces that I see here. It's been quite a while since we've been together, but I still see a lot of your usual spaces. And I look forward to the time when we can fill those spots again. So as you finish your message, I'll give you another couple seconds for that. You can continue doing that as we move on here. But I just have a couple of announcements for you yet. Danny Plett is returning to long-term mission work through Teach Beyond. And there's going to be a video shown in a minute or two that will provide some information about that. We will have a question and response time following the sermon, and so we invite you to consider some questions that you might have as you listen to Pastor Garry's message soon. And we'd also like to just thank you for your faithful giving in 2020. It was a pretty crazy year in a lot of ways, but 2020, our giving actually exceeded the giving of 2019. So praise the Lord for that. Our trustees will share some more about that in the near future. I'd like to invite you to pray with me. Heavenly Father, we come before you today, people who are in need of your grace. And we give you praise for your faithfulness and your righteousness and your sovereign power. And we praise you, God, for being the one true God who is greater than any of life's circumstances, greater than all of our doubts, and greater than our present sufferings. And Lord, we trust that you are our ultimate source of joy. And yet in these times, Lord, we are struggling as a people and as a church. Lord, we can identify with the psalmist who writes in Psalm 42, "My heart is breaking as I remember how it used to be. I walked among the crowds of worshipers leading a great procession to the house of God, singing for joy and giving thanks amid the sound of great celebration. Why am I discouraged? Why is my heart so sad?" And Lord, my prayer for all those who are listening today is that they would be willing to share some of these deepest longings and disappointments, these frustrations and the despair that they are feeling. Lord, I am tired of this season of isolation. I miss seeing family and friends. I miss seeing our youth. I miss seeing our church family who are here. Lord, I miss the activities that we enjoy. I'm tired of reading about the online drama and the cruel comments that people make toward one another. Lord, I'm tired of the constant struggle to find accurate information. I'm discouraged by the news of civil unrest, and my heart hurts for those who are caught in the middle of all of this. And Lord, my heart goes out to those who are lonely and who are isolated. And for those who are dealing with physical and mental illnesses, who are having to battle this without the support that they would have typically received, Lord, it is heavy. But the psalmist says, I put my hope in God, and I will yet praise him, my Savior, my God. And so, Lord, we thank you that in your grace you invite our honest, heartfelt thoughts and our pain and our struggles. And our hope and our prayer, O God, is that you would heal your people and that you would give strength to your people and that you would give us fresh eyes to see your glory and your beauty all around us. And I pray that that you would give us just eyes and ears to hear our neighbors and our church family who are struggling. And Lord, give us energy and the heart to listen and to reach out. Help us, I pray. And Lord, as we reflect on the year that has been and the giving that has come in, we give you thanks. We give you praise, Lord, for how you have inspired your people to be generous and to give in a time of uncertainty. So Lord, as we look ahead to the new year, Lord, we put our trust in you. I pray this all in the powerful name of our merciful Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Good morning. We are Danny and Sherry Plett, and we want to share with you our work with Teach Beyond. It began in 1992 when we moved to Germany with our baby daughter to begin full-time music ministry with Jan's team. In 2013, through prayer, we made the decision to return to Canada. Danny took the position of worship pastor at Emmanuel Free Church here in Steinbeck. And after 6 years, it was time to change again. Through prayer, we returned to Teach Beyond in May of 2020.
Did you know that Teach Beyond began as the Jan's team? It utilized the preaching of the gospel and progressive music to bring the gospel to post-World War II Germany. The work of Teach Beyond has always been and continues to be about the transformation that can happen through Christ. Were you also aware that only one-third of the world's population falls into the category of Christian, with a huge number of these being Christian in name only? Our work is really far from over. With Teach Beyond, we want to help this generation of influencers to bring Jesus to the world. Teach Beyond's vision statement says, "We wholeheartedly desire to serve our Father's world, to love Jesus Christ, and to see individuals and communities transformed by His Spirit." In my ministry, I'll be partnering with local churches and Christian organizations in the countries of Germany, Belarus, Brazil, and the Ukraine. My work will include concerts and other music events, recordings, classroom and pre-recorded video teaching modules, and personal mentoring of young worship leaders and musicians.
My involvement is, as it always has been, to stand with Danny and support him in his work. I hope there will be opportunity for me to sometimes travel with him and to help with the logistics of the various tours. In addition, I also work with Teach Beyond in the role of conference planning. Our global conference was scheduled for this past April, but with the pandemic, has been postponed until 2022.
Our ministry base will remain here in Steinbeck, and from here, once international travel is again allowed, I will travel to Germany twice a year with one trip per year to either Belarus, Brazil, or Ukraine. This will involve 25 to 30 worship concerts or music events per year, studio recordings, and also involve coaching, teaching, and mentoring. My Canadian ministry tasks will be ministry preparation, home office administration, songwriting, writing new coaching and teaching material, planning, organizing, and executing the Great Hallelujah Project. The next Great Hallelujah Project was scheduled for fall of 2021, but due to the pandemic, we've had to put this project on hold. If any of you want to get in contact with us, please reach out at dplett@teachbeyond.org. I'll repeat that, dplett@teachbeyond.org. Thank you.
Let's continue singing together. For all you've done, my Savior, my Redeemer, lifted me from the miry clay.
Mm-hmm. Good morning, church. Well, we had communion last Sunday. If you had joined with us, then you will have participated in communion with us. And I look forward to the time when we are gathered together around the communion table in person. I look forward to sitting together with you for a cup of coffee, having lunch together, having a sandwich, something warm to eat. I have a bit of a quiz that I wanted to start off with this morning. Let's put this first word up as we're talking about lunch and sandwiches and so on. Here's the first word. What fill in the missing letter to this word. And maybe you can write it in the comments section of YouTube, or you can say it out loud where you are. What is this word? Put the last letter in there and think of that last word. And as we're talking about lunch and sandwiches and so on. We also are busy writing or washing our hands. We continue to wash our hands regularly and sanitize. I think I have strategically located moisturizer and sanitizer at different places. I've already run out of one and had to replenish my moisturizer and sanitizer in my office here in the church. But we continue to wash our hands and sanitize and moisturize and wash and clean and all of that that's going on. And so I want to continue with this quiz again this morning, and I'd like you to put up that second word and finish this. Put a letter in here that finishes that word as we're finishing talking about washing our hands and so on. So write that into the comment section. What's the letter and what's the word that comes to mind? Maybe you say it out loud. All right. Now, let's finish off this little quiz here this morning. I don't see the comments or hear what you've said, obviously, but that first word I'm going to guess you put a U in there, and the first word was soup. I'm going to guess that the second word you put an A in there, and you were thinking of the word soap, most likely. This is the power of suggestion. We've just demonstrated the power of suggestion because those words could actually be interchangeable. But by saying a few words and giving a few phrases and indications, we were able to suggest and therefore have you fill those words in a certain way. That is a form of what could be called priming. We make associations all the time in life. And priming is a primary aspect, an important aspect, an influential aspect of our making associations. We actually have what one psychologist and Nobel laureate calls an associative machine. So we make these associations, and that happens when we give reminders, ideas, prime, and our behavior. And vice versa, behavior can also prime our thinking. People associate God with the church. People associate God with the church. Scripture talks about that a great deal, especially in the New Testament. If you have been listening to worship services, attending worship services, then you have heard those ideas. If you talk to friends or neighbors or people in the community, you will hear this idea that people associate God with church. Now, some people's experience of church is positive. But for many people, it's also negative. People who are not going to church, not attending a worship service, not part of a congregation. For some people, their experience is that the congregation, the church body, is harsh. Or maybe it's closed. It's not a place for them. Or maybe I heard some children actually say that It's for old people. Or maybe church for some is a place that takes. Church takes. It takes your dreams. It takes your aspirations. It says, no, don't do this or don't do that. If you are a pastor's child or a missionary's child, then maybe church takes your father or takes your mother. Or maybe church has been confusing. Because you attend as a child, you attend a church with your mother or father or both. And you sit nicely in church, but at home there's anger. Or maybe confusion because your parents sit together in church, but then at some point down the road they get divorced. So this idea that we have this associative machine, we make these associations, this associative machine that we have is in itself not wrong or bad or sinful. So have we got this idea that associating God with church, is that actually wrong? Has Scripture got it wrong? Or could it be that we have got something wrong with our understanding of church? What church is meant to be human and to be church. Paul, in his letter to the Ephesians, at the time, the city of Ephesus was buzzing with activity. Commerce, entertainment, religious cults. And like most major urban centers, there were a variety of nations in the city of Ephesus. And a Christian church had been established in this city. And Paul is writing this letter and he is addressing the multitude of nations that are in this city. And particularly that are a part of this new church. And he is explaining a revelation that he has been given by God, a revelation that he communicates to this burgeoning church in Ephesus. The content of this revelation that we talked about last week that bears reiterating now this morning, the content of the revelation is this, that the Gentiles, which is a short form for all nations, that the Gentiles, all nations, and the Jews are united together through Christ Jesus. The revelation is that all nations, the Gentiles and the Jews, God's view is that they are all meant to be together as one family. That God has reconciled all of humanity to himself and also through Jesus Christ established peace amongst humankind. This is the revelation, and Paul describes this with three distinctives. He says that all the nations are fellow heirs. That is that all nations are equal receivers of this unearned gift. The second descriptor that he uses is that they are members of the same body, that they are co-equal and united, that all nations and the Jews together are united together through Jesus Christ. And then the third descriptor he uses is that they are participants of the promise, that they are participants together of the covenant that God has made, that they can be assured of this. And this revelation is news to all the nations and news to the Jewish people as well. It is news to them because it has been obscured or hidden and in the shadow up until the point of Jesus Christ, and now the revelation is communicated through Paul. The revelation, this revelation, communicates and reveals the character of God. It describes it, it shows what God is like. So it is not merely that a God exists, but he is particular. He has certain attributes. He is a certain kind of God. And revealing this communicates a very important message to all the nations. It is a message to all the nations that, remember, you have been included in the family of God. You are part of the kingdom, part of the family. Listen, it is not that Israel has been replaced or been substituted or subordinated. Rather, it is that all nations are equally included. This was an important message to the Gentiles, to all the nations in their day, and it remains an important and an essential message in Revelation today because of our human propensity to exclude. Our proclivity, our inclination to be self-centered. And so it was a message to the people of the day in Ephesus, and it was a reminder because even previously Israel had become exclusive and self-centered. And now as the message Paul is revealing to the Gentiles in Ephesus is to remind them not to become exclusive, not to become self-centered, not to become a place where they are excluding other people and consider other people less than themselves. That is a danger. So this has been God's plan. This is God's plan for the church. But why does he communicate this plan? Why does he reveal this plan? Why not just go ahead and do it? Why not just invite and include people from different nations into the church? But why reveal his purpose? Now, we understand from Scripture that the Lord judges nations. It is not that he only judges individuals. In fact, Scripture primarily addresses the corporate body. It primarily addresses the plural as opposed to the singular. God judges nations, not only individuals. And he holds churches accountable. He holds congregations accountable, not merely individuals. We read in a lot of the books of the New Testament are addresses to the church. And then we get to the book of Revelation, and before too long into the book, we hear again direct addresses to specific churches. Ephesians, the church in Ephesus, is one of those being addressed in Revelation 2. The Lord holds congregations accountable. So why is a diverse church divine? Turn with me to Ephesians, an ethnically diverse church. Why is that particularly divine? And so turn with me to Ephesians chapter 3. I'm going to read starting at verse 7. Ephesians 3 starting at verse 7. 7 to 9. Of this gospel, Paul writes, I have become a servant according to the gift of God's grace that was given me by the working of his power. Although I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to me to bring to the Gentiles the news of the boundless riches of Christ and to make everyone see what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things. So Paul is saying that the grace that he has been given is a grace to communicate what the Lord has in mind. To communicate this to all the nations. This is a tell-all plan, tell-everybody kind of plan. And so we continue in Ephesians 3 now, starting at verse 10 to 12. So that, why? So that through the church, the wisdom of God, in its rich variety, might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was in accordance with the eternal purpose that he has carried out in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have access to God in boldness and confidence through faith in him. So the Gentiles are not the final beneficiary of this revelation. It doesn't end with them. The church is given a very specific, important assignment that is to the benefit of the whole world. And this is according to God's eternal purpose. His reason, his why, was before he began to create, this is what he had in mind. That the church would be this way. This is what it means to be church. That the congregation would reveal God's wisdom. It would reveal, in one translation, the manifold wisdom. The variety of wisdom. God's many-sided, diverse, complex wisdom. A diverse congregation reveals the diverse wisdom of God. Now, for a church congregation, for a people to live with this kind of variety and this background is complex. It's complicated. Because, well, people in a variety of backgrounds and ethnicities, they dress differently. They eat different food. They smell differently because of the food we eat. They speak differently. They think differently. It is actually a mixed up church in this sense. But it is precisely a congregation of variety and diversity that at the same time has love and joy and peace, that has unity. It is that kind of a body that demonstrates and reveals the very complex wisdom of God, because the only way that that is possible is due to the love of God the Father, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the partnership in the work of the Holy Spirit. So mixing it up is divine. Mixing it up is the wisdom of God. But notice who this revelation is meant to. The first priority, do you notice that the priority of this message, who it is aimed at? It is meant for, in the first instance, a revelation and a message to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This is a shorthand for the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places. Listen, there are spiritual forces at work in this world other than God. And the diverse congregation is a declaration that the kingdom of God has been planted and present on earth. The spiritual forces of wickedness are against our Creator. They are against human beings. But the coming together and the unity that is present among a diverse congregation is a message loud and clear. It is as though the congregation is this conduit, this carrier of the very wisdom and Spirit of God, like a tube that is carrying light. The congregation is this vessel of this bright and brilliant light, like a neon sign on earth, this neon sign that says, the Lord is present. This is the Lord's wisdom. This is the diversity and the complexity of the Lord. It is proof. This neon sign, this congregation is proof, a sign and a symbol that there are other new, different systems and structures and patterns that exist on this world. Systems and structures and patterns where unity amidst diversity is not only present and possible, but it's beautiful and wonderful. And where true love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, and self-control flourish. It spans the body, it spans bodily existence, spiritual existence, it spans social and economic strata. Friends, There are spiritual forces at work in our world other than the Lord Jesus Christ, other than the Spirit of God. Those spiritual forces are intent on disunity, on disorder. They are the authors and agents of violence, of vitriol, of chaos, and confusion and unrest. They are the agents of those kinds of activities, postures, and attitudes, ultimately leading to destruction. But the very wisdom of God is a divine, entire, alternate way of being human and being church. It confronts that way of being. It confronts and reveals that way of being and offers a different way of being human and being church. It means being present. God coming and being present. First, we see it most clearly in Jesus, and now we see that presence continuing and extended to the church. Present. But it's a particular kind of presence. We see this. It is a Trinitarian presence. It is a unity of difference. We saw that in Jesus Christ. We heard the voice of the Father. We saw the presence of the Holy Spirit and the work of Jesus the Son. It is that Trinitarian presence. It is precisely a presence that is a unity of difference. Now from Jesus, as we see extended into the church, that is meant to be a unity of difference. And also marriage. The holiness of the covenant of marriage is a unity of difference. This presence that is particular to a unity of difference necessarily means relationship. A kind of relationship that the Lord has sought with us and that the church now extends, and we enter into relationship with each other, but also with all the world. So this associative machine that we have is good and it's beautiful and it's meant for good. But it then necessarily requires us to have an understanding of the very character of God, what He is like, and understanding the purpose and the why of church. The spiritual forces of wickedness benefit from conflict. When you go onto your social media and you fan the flames of conflict, spiritual forces of wickedness benefit. But when we come together, when we are united precisely amidst our differences, we are revealing the very wisdom of the Lord. Rather than sustaining our in-groups, sustaining our position in our posture or the vacuum that we live in, we identify with the Lord Jesus Christ. We are ordained a church with a special role to mix it up. People, when they associate love and joy and peace with the church, they are drawn towards the church. And because people associate God with the church, they are then likewise drawn towards the Lord. And the gospel is expanded because people are drawn towards love and grace and mercy. They are compelled towards it. And this is the power of the gospel. I want to pause here before I go further. And I want to invite you to ask your questions. I have sought over the years to engender a posture of humility in dialogue. I continue to beseech you to ask questions. For children to ask questions. Teenagers and young adults, ask questions. In your homes, and now here too, we can ask questions as it relates to what we've been talking about to this passage. Ask your questions. You can type them into the comment section of YouTube, or you can email or text to the address ask@semconline.com. You see that address on your screen. And we'd be happy to respond to a few of your questions before we close this morning. J-Man?
Yeah. I was thinking about diversity. We see it, you know, so prominently now in the United States. And what are some of the practical benefits of diversity in the church when we see so much obvious conflict
right.
amongst diversity?
Right, right. You know, and that's interesting. I wonder if that word diversity has taken on a negative connotation. I know sometimes when I talk to people and they hear that word diversity, they get all kinds of nervousness to them. But what are some practical implications, right? Well, let me, the zinger is this, that you and I only have some of the information. In order for us to know completely or know more fully, we need to actually hear from other people. I talked at one point about our System 1 and System 2, and our System 1 jumps to conclusions. It takes a couple of pieces and then tries to assemble a picture, assemble a puzzle with only two or three pieces because it's simple, but it's not necessarily the best. So let me give you an example. If I really want to understand an aspect of the gospel, if I want to understand the Lord more fully, if I want to live a life a certain way, then I actually need to hear from other people so that I grow. An illustration, watching hockey. So I've been watching some hockey lately. Back in the day when we could be in an arena, okay? I'm sitting on the blue line, near the blue line, and I'm watching the game from the blue line. You're at the same hockey game, but you're sitting behind one of the nets, further up and behind one of the nets, right? The whistle blows, there's an offside. And you're freaking out because from your vantage point, there's no way that was offside. I'm sitting where I'm sitting. We're watching the same game. But I'm sitting on the blue line and I can see it clearly that that was offside. Now, if it's the game is just everybody sitting in that spot, then there's going to be all this outrage. But if one of the options is that I could go or you could go and sit in different spots and live in different circumstances in life, or we could talk to each other. So what the enemy, the spiritual forces of wickedness, what they are doing is they are encouraging us to camp where we are and to force a position, they call it. You know, I'm right, you're wrong, and we do this, as opposed to taking a beat and listening and seeking to understand. So that when I hear someone from another culture, when I hear someone from India talking how beautifully about their experience of the Lord, their experience of the Holy Spirit, and it just fills in more of the richness. When I hear somebody from the Philippines talking about their experience of fellowship together around the table, it fills in a much richer picture of the Lord and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. Yeah, I hope that
helps. That's good. That humility, that's a kind of a starting point.
Right.
I remember I was sitting at my kitchen table, and there's this nice window by the street, and I was watching somebody walk the couple was walking their dog along the street, and I thought, there's this nice sidewalk. Why wouldn't you walk on the sidewalk? And so here I am in my heart, I'm already judging these people for right. this. And then Paige is sitting across the table, and she sees the other side, and she says, because I actually said it out loud.
Right.
And... Oops.
Why not?
Anyway, she says there was another couple walking a bigger dog there, and they're just trying to keep their space so right. there's not a conflict. I'm like,
right.
Oh,
right.
Okay. Sorry.
Yeah.
For
right.
my.
Right. And you actually said the phrase, she saw the other side.
Yeah.
So actually, literally, saw the other part.
Yeah, that's good.
Right? Yeah, it's really good.
I have one question that came up here. Why is there always conflict with the churches in Manitoba?
Okay.
It's a certain perspective.
Yeah. Why are there always conflicts with the churches in Manitoba? It's interesting. I would say that it's not... There's conflict like amongst the churches or within a church itself. I'm not quite sure of that question. you know, conflicts within the church or conflicts between churches. But I will say that it's not unique to Manitoba. There are a plethora of churches in Canada and around the world. And typically, I think at the high level, what I would say is that when a congregation loses sight of what it means to be church, it can very quickly become a case of preferences and divisions and separations and segregations. And that's not unique to Manitoba. I mean, picture this. You have this church in Ephesus with this cult going on, this huge temple Artemis. They're literally carving idols, and it's an affluent city. And then this burgeoning Christian church develops. And now you have all these nations coming together in this church with this temple above it, and all these people who were worshiping and doing all this stuff, and now they're coming together, and they are a church together, and now they're a bunch of leaders that are leading this church. Could you imagine the kerfuffle and the challenges that they had? And yet the very revelation that Paul gives that church is the variety demonstrates the variety of God's wisdom. And now, basically, churches want to go like one kind of this, one kind of this, one kind of this. You're in or you're out. And it's so binary.
Hmm. Even just seeing the different gifts that we see within our church is a beautiful thing.
Exactly, right?
We need that.
Yeah, we totally need that. Yeah. We so need that.
Yeah, so value, perspectives is good too.
Oh, that's so good.
One more question here.
Yeah.
Should the local church make diversity a goal or something to be open to within our contexts?
Okay. Yeah, that's great. That's a really good question. Is diversity a goal or is it an outcome? Did I get it right?
Or something to be open to within our context.
Something to be open to within our context. That's very good. Right. So that's really good. So is diversity the goal or is it something simply to be open to?
Right.
Very good. So yes, diversity is not the goal, okay? The goal is for the congregation to amplify, to extend the presence of the Lord, to reveal his manifold wisdom, to embody the gospel. That's the goal, to make much of the Lord, okay? That's the goal. But that will necessarily mean, if that is our goal, that will mean a diverse congregation. Because the Lord, there's unity in the Trinity, and he has revealed that that's his desire for the church. So then the answer is, we need to be open to that and willing and submit to that. And that is why he has revealed this to the church, so that we will lean in and be open to that. Excellent question.
Mm. Yeah, spirit of invitation.
Spirit of invitation, spirit of openness, spirit of humility, willing to listen, seeking to understand.
This is good. I have one more here.
Okay, and then we'll wrap it up.
Do we need to fear the evil spiritual forces, or can we have complete confidence and peace in the superior power of Jesus Christ?
Excellent. So do we need to fear the spiritual forces of wickedness, or can we have confidence because of the superior capability of the Lord Jesus Christ?
Yes.
Excellent. And I like that a lot. Again, really good questions, you all. This is good. So again, fear as in an emotion or a feeling that causes me to cower or to hide and so on. No, the Lord does not want us to fear. And we see verses in Isaiah, we see throughout Scripture from Old to New Testament. He does not want us to live in fear. But we should acknowledge and respect and understand that these spiritual forces of wickedness are present and active, not only the Lord. And that we need to call on them. We need to recognize the agency of our attitudes and activities. When we are, like I said, when we are advancing things that are destructive, violent, etc., the agency of that are the spiritual forces of wickedness. So we don't need to fear them. absolutely right. The Lord's power is more superior. And so we need to invoke the Lord Jesus Christ and ask him to do battle in the spiritual realm, not take on the spiritual forces of wickedness ourselves. And so this is a theme in Paul, and specifically in the book of Ephesians, when we're going to get to later on in the later parts. So not that we now confront the spiritual forces of wickedness directly ourselves. We invoke the power of the Holy Spirit, invoke the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to do battle in the spiritual realm, but absolutely revere that and understand that that is what's happening, this cosmic battle.
Amen. Right on.
Yeah. And so from here, maybe I'll just conclude here. Where do we go from here? Look, this is both marvelous and challenging for us as a congregation. It's marvelous because it means that we are all meant to be part of God's family, but it's also challenging because we need help for this to work, for God's purpose and plan to be real in our lives and in our congregation. We need help. We need help from the Holy Spirit, and we need help from people that are ethnically diverse. We need help from people that are different than we are. We need their help. We need to learn. We need to understand. We need to have their participation and involvement. And so what I ask is, what will that take? And I understand that we are seconded or sequestered, rather, right now, that we are isolated and so on. And so what I ask you is, what will it take? Well, you are in this life that you are in. What will it take? A mind shift, a praying to the Lord, an openness to cross a social, economic, age, gender barriers that you have built up, to make a phone call to someone that is other than your background or whatever, to have a driveway conversation or whatever it is. What will it take so that, what will it take now in the current circumstance that we're in, but what will it take so that when we come back together, and we're coming back together, what will it take that when we come back together, we will be stronger and it'll be more profound than all you could ask or imagine? And that is for next Sunday.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Garry. As we get ready to play this final song for you, to sing it with you, it's just struck me in a new way, in this season. There's a lot of us are going through some hard things, and this has been a very difficult season. And I pray that this song is a blessing to you this morning. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, 'cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus. Every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus form a family, I speak the holy name. Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I seek the holy name.
As we close our service this morning, we invite you to check out our website and stay up to date with all the stuff that's going on. You will find our bulletin there as well. We also invite you to subscribe to our YouTube channel. You can click that notification button and get notifications for when we go live. We also have a membership meeting coming up on January 25th. It's a Monday, and it will take place online using a program called Zoom. And so if you need help setting that up, please let us know. And we invite you to keep asking your questions. You can ask further questions regarding the sermon today, or if you have other stuff that's percolating, feel free to share those. You can text or email them to ask@SEMCOnline.com. So for youth and young adults, we'd love to hear from you too. For our benediction this morning, from Jude chapter verses 24 and 25. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
There's a song in my soul, and I feel it stirring in me. This I know for sure, that your love is like a flood, and your mercy never ended. I give my soul to you. There's a joy in my soul, and it rises like a morning. This I know for sure, that your grace is enough, and your promise never breaks.
Roll up. I breathe, singing and hold me, hold me. Let my life be to you a symphony, singing and hold me, hold me. Yeah, yeah. And all my days, every single breath I breathe, singing and hold me. You are holy for all of your good. Never stop moving. Wait.